Hi, my name is Stephanie. I'm a physician assistant, McMaster grad of 2015, and I currently work in maternal fetal medicine, high-risk obstetrics at McMaster Hospital.
Stephanie, can you tell us a little bit about yourself?
So I'm originally from Windsor. I went to the McMaster PA program. I graduated in 2015, and you know what? I fell in love with Hamilton when I was there. I really liked the outdoorsiness of it, but still a big city, so I wanted to stay. And it just so happened that when I graduated, there was a great job opportunity that was actually my dream job in maternal fetal medicine. So I took that job there, and it ended up working out really well. So I've been in Hamilton in maternal fetal medicine for pretty much 4 years exactly. Maybe 2 weeks from now is when my four-year anniversary is for that. So I've been with that team for a while.
Mm-hmm. Can you tell us a little bit about what you were doing before you started your PA journey?
So before I started my PA journey, I did my undergrad at Western University. I had my undergrad sort of in a science-based area as well. So I knew I was interested in at least the medical world from early on. And so I did my undergrad in physiology, and there were a lot of pharmacology courses that I took as well. And that was a huge asset actually when it came to the PA program. While I was in undergrad, I had a great opportunity to shadow some physicians, actually some obstetrics and gynecologist physicians as well, and I was actually able to have the opportunity to do some research in intrauterine growth restriction, and was able to get a publication out of that actually. So I think I was well equipped going into the PA program with all of that background.
And were you contemplating other careers at the time in healthcare?
Yeah, for sure. How can you not? I looked through everything. I looked at the MD route and realized that was, for a lot of people, a long, hard route. And even after you start working, it's long hours. So from a lifestyle perspective, I think I considered it, but I wanted to look at other things as well. And I looked through everything, anything from genetic counselor, physiotherapist, occupational therapist, and I actually even thought about nurse practitioner as well. I had applied to the nurse accelerated nursing program in London, but actually I decided to stick with my physiology degree instead. Trying to pursue what I wanted as a career, one of the nights looking through the internet trying to figure out what would be good for me, I kind of stumbled on the idea of the physician assistant program. And it was actually in the context of the US programs that I stumbled upon it. And then I did a little bit more research into it and realized there was a Canadian program. So it was actually something that I came across on my own.
You applied and got into the PA program. Mm-hmm. And how did you enjoy PA school at Mac?
I loved it. I was a little nervous about the self-directed learning aspect of it because coming from an undergrad that was very didactic, I had no experience with problem-based learning, so I didn't really know what to expect. I had read about it, but I wasn't quite sure, and I actually realized it worked well with me. And having a good foundation in the medical sciences, I think, really helped with that aspect of things. And being able to self-schedule myself and study and work when it was best for my personality and my lifestyle, I think really helped with that.
So the program at Mac in first year has students do longitudinal placements or half-day observerships. So where did you end up doing some of your LPs?
So my first LP was actually with a fellow PA, Denise O'Leary, in the family clinic that she was at. And it was a really interesting experience. It was early on. I didn't have that much exposure to all the body systems at that point. I think we had just learned about the respiratory system and the cardiac system. So going in and seeing how a PA functions was a big deal to me. And I was able to get my first real hands-on experience with some patients, even though it was just taking some small histories or practicing my examination skills, it made a big difference early on. From there, I did a ride out with an EMS, which was an interesting experience just to see what happens before people come into hospital and how that works. So my third LP was with obstetrics and gynecology, but I actually was with someone in the fertility aspect of things. So to see that aspect was really cool as well.
Mm-hmm. And second year PA school, of course, consists of core and elective rotations. How did you enjoy clerkship?
Clerkship was an eye-opening experience as well. I always tell people who are in the PA program now that you're going to learn at such an accelerated rate in clerkship compared to what you're doing on your own reading about it. The amount that you retain when you're studying around an actual real-life patient rather than just a case you're reading in the textbook is helpful, at least for me, for memory purposes. So I did most of my rotations in the Hamilton area because I knew I liked Hamilton and wanted to stay there. And I liked the idea of being in an academic center for my rotations. A lot of them were in this area. It was challenging at first because it was hours that I wasn't used to and trying to keep up with my studying in addition to my clinical work. It was a bit of a challenge at first, but I think overall it was a great experience to get that hands-on learning.
And what did you end up doing your elective rotations?
I actually did quite a few elective rotations because I split them up a little bit. So I did in maternal fetal medicine, which is the actual job that I have now. I did 4 weeks there. And it was a great way to get an introduction to an area of medicine that I was very interested in. And it almost acted, I think, like a preliminary job interview. So my bosses now got to know me as a student and see different aspects of my personality if I worked with the team. And hopefully, you know, that lands you with a job. And for me, it did. So that was a really good experience. Because I liked all of medicine, I knew I liked obstetrics and gynecology, but I did really like everything else as well. I did a lot of the internal medicine subspecialties. So I did some endocrinology and I did some cardiology just to get some more experience with that. And lastly, I did a neurosurgery elective, mostly because that was an area that I didn't feel was my strong suit.
And did you have any idea where you were going to end up working or know where to work during PA school?
So it was a really big unknown at first, as I think it is all is with all PA students, where you're going to end up afterwards. And there's a little bit of stress with that. But I was hopeful about the new Career Start grant that came out, and I wanted to wait to see what job opportunities there were. I was willing to move for the perfect job, so I wasn't overly stressed, I guess, about staying in one location and finding a job in a certain city, so I think that was helpful as well. But I kept an eye out for any job opportunities that came up after I graduated, and I even kept an eye out before school even ended, just to see if there was something that I could apply to even before graduating.
For those that aren't familiar, how would you describe the specialty?
So maternal fetal medicine is a subspecialty of obstetrics and gynecology that really focuses on obstetrics only. So we see patients that are pregnant, and usually there's another comorbidity happening at the same time, whether it's maternal or whether it's fetal, or it could even be both. So an example of a maternal pathology that we see a lot, some of the common things are rheumatologic diseases in pregnancy. Many young women have things like lupus, for example. Some people have cardiac pathologies, whether it's something congenital that the mom themselves were born with or something acquired later on in life. We see a lot of type 1 and type 2 diabetes and their associated complications as well. From a fetal perspective, we see anything from, you know, rare genetic diseases to things like Down syndrome or different fetal anomalies that are associated with genetic syndromes in general.
And how is this patient population different than ones that you'd see in family med?
The big obvious thing is that they're pregnant. So a lot of time, pregnancy is a big black box for a lot of care providers. And especially if someone comes in with a medical disorder and they happen to be pregnant, I think that's an area of discomfort for a lot of other adult care providers or pediatric care providers. So where maternal fetal medicine kind of comes in is that we can bridge that gap between the medicine and the pregnancy sort of thing.
And what's your role as a PA within this specialty?
So I have, I think, a pretty unique role as a PA in maternal fetal medicine because I not only get to do outpatient, but I also get to do inpatient. There's actually two PAs, so myself and a colleague, that rotate back and forth doing inpatient and outpatient with the 7 maternal fetal medicine specialists that are there at McMaster Hospital. In the outpatient setting, in clinic, I'll see usually new consults that come in. So I get to spend a lot of time with these patients doing histories and physical examinations. They usually get an obstetric ultrasound before coming to our appointment, so I get to review that information with the patient as well. And lots of counseling and lots of education. Sometimes people aren't even sure why they're here in the high-risk clinic, so I have to really start from scratch with that. I do also see some follow-up patients as well, so there is continuity there. Sometimes I have to order investigations like genetic testing or blood work or ultrasounds for another couple weeks from now. In the inpatient setting, we have patients that are admitted to hospital because of potentially medical complications that are happening or obstetric complications. We'll round on them in the mornings and see how they're doing each day and make little tweaks to their management plan. Similar things like ordering ultrasounds and doing blood work. We have people who've already had babies and they're postpartum, so I'll see them. And of course, we have people on the labor and delivery ward. So we'll see people in labor and follow them, and we'll first assist with cesarean sections as well, whether they're scheduled or whether they're more emergent. We also have a little triage unit, which I describe to patients as a mini emergency room for pregnant patients. So that's where the more undifferentiated patient might come in with something like maybe vague abdominal pain, and you have to sort of work them up from scratch. So different procedures, that the big one would be cesarean sections. So I'm often required to go to the operating room as a assist for cesarean sections. And that's a skill set that, I mean, any PA can do, but we were able to get a little bit of extra training specifically with first assist in cesarean sections. So that's a role that I really enjoy, actually. And we get to help out with deliveries as well, so vaginal deliveries. Lots of other little procedures that happen that are specific to obstetrics and specific to high-risk obstetrics as well that we help out with. I really like my role as a physician assistant in maternal fetal medicine because I think what I can do is I can spend a lot more time focusing on things like patient education and a lot of the little things that it might not be the main chief complaint that a patient comes in with, but when a patient comes for the first time, maybe it's their first pregnancy, there's a lot of questions that and a lot of education that needs to happen. And being able to sit down and focus on that aspect of things, maybe prevention, maybe smoking cessation, I think is really useful and key for a lot of women going through a successful pregnancy. Going through, especially when there might be some bad news that happens, oftentimes there is a longer conversation that happens with social workers and a group of people about decision making in a pregnancy, for example. So I definitely play a role in that as well.
How were you oriented to the service when you were first hired?
So I was really lucky to have a fantastic PA colleague, Jessica, who started maybe 6 months before I did. So I had a great mentor to start out with, and I think that was a fantastic help to my learning because I got to see what she did. It also really helped that I was a student there before I started, so I sort of knew the workings of the clinic and the hospital before I started, and I knew what to expect.
What's the mentoring like between the PA and the physician?
So in terms of the PA-MD relationship, we're very our MDs, the maternal fetal medicine specialists, are very involved in a lot of the patient care because it is a really high-risk population. So I always tell people that with, and this is maybe my opinion, but with a more subspecialized area, sometimes PAs lose a little bit of autonomy, but I don't think it's a bad thing because I'm working very closely with people with a ton of extra training and a ton of knowledge and information about sometimes very rare, you know, genetic things, for example. So usually I see a patient, I do the initial history, physical examination, I'll order blood work, I'll wait for that blood work to come back, if it's at an inpatient setting, and sort of put all the pieces together, and I'll start with counseling the patient or talking to them about the management plan. Usually when I'm done that, I'll review with the MD that I'm with, and they'll come in and always meet the patient before they go.
Do you work with medical directives?
I do. So we have medical directives that we've sort of developed from scratch, with obstetrics being sort of a unique role for a PA. So we have directives, they're always under review, and we're always changing them, actually, which I think is really unique because as my skill set's growing, I'm able to actually go back and add more to the directives, something that I might not have been able to do 4 years ago and that I'm able to do now. Well, we can go back and we can add that in.
Mm-hmm. And do you prescribe medications or initiate management?
So we do a lot of management with patients. Medications themselves, not as common with pregnancy, so there's only a few select medications that we do use. So we'll talk to them, I'll talk to a patient about the medications, and we usually get a cosign from the physician, but I sort of start that initiation process.
The PA role is often described as it's like working with a resident that never leaves your practice. Would you say that that's fairly accurate, or are there some similarities and differences when it comes to a PA?
I would definitely agree with that statement that a PA is very similar to a resident. And the nice thing about the PA being there on a more long-term basis is that we get to see the little workings of how certain tests are ordered or some specialty things, how they're occurring in the hospital. When a PA is there more long-term, you can see how each different specialist maybe has a certain preference in ways in that you would manage patients, and being there long-term, you can pick up on that a little bit more. A big difference between the OBGYN residents and the PAs would be probably the surgical aspect of things, because they are training to be surgeons, whereas my role is to be a first assist, so I would say that's a big difference from a procedural standpoint.
How do you interact with other staff like nursing or allied health?
I think we interact very well with other allied health. I work a lot with nurses, both in the clinic and in the hospital setting. And being there for so long, I think everyone is used to how the PA role works and knows us by name and knows us by face, and it works out really well. They know they can page me for certain things and I'll always answer, so I think that's been helpful to them. We work closely with dietitians as well, especially with, for example, our diabetic population, and with the physicians, of course, as well.
What impact has the department seen since adding PAs?
So I don't have any numbers for you, but I think when the PAs came on, it was at a time where there was a bigger and bigger need for maternal fetal medicine. Perhaps this was because of people delaying pregnancy until they're a little bit older, or maybe people getting comorbidities when they're younger, but there was a much higher need for maternal fetal medicine. And adding on the PAs has, I think, allowed our clinic to accommodate that need. Being a tertiary center, we sometimes can't say no to people who are coming from far and wide needing our hospital for various reasons. So it's allowed us to see patients in a timely fashion, which you have to when they're pregnant because you can't have a 6-month waiting list. So I think the PAs has really allowed that to happen. And I think having PAs in the maternal fetal medicine service in general has decreased the workload and the burden on a lot of the other care providers, and allowed the workload to be sort of spread between more people. And I've noticed comments from some of the people that I work with that they're able to finish maybe a little bit earlier because we have some people sharing the work.
And how do you keep up on new treatment and management or research in OBGYN?
So I am lucky enough to be a member of the Society of Obstetricians and Gynecologists of Canada, and they post a lot of new research and guidelines all the time, so I try to keep up to date by reading that. Being in an academic center, there's weekly rounds that happen. People go over different topics as it relates to obstetrics. That's sort of built into my schedule each week, sort of a forced learning, if that makes sense. Of course, I go home and look up things around certain patients that I know I'll be seeing in the clinic. If I know it's something that I haven't seen before, maybe a weird genetic condition. There's actually quite a few good conferences, a lot of them in Toronto actually, that I try to go to at least one or two a year to keep up with the knowledge.
What are they called?
So they're all done through Mount Sinai Hospital, these conferences, and the Obstetrics and Gynecology Department there. So they usually get people, for example, maternal fetal medicine specialists from the tertiary centers through Ontario to come do talks. For example, there's one, I think, coming soon about obesity and pregnancy. So it's just a whole day to talk about the various issues surrounding that.
And what do you enjoy about maternal fetal medicine? Like, what gets you really excited to come?
The big thing that gets me excited, I would say, is the variety that I see. So although every specialty has its bread and butter, I think some days you will see very specific pregnancy complications, whereas some days we'll see more medical complications. And really, pregnant women, they're adults, they can have anything happen to them, any pathology. So going into work not really knowing what to expect keeps me on my toes and keeps it enjoyable. The other thing that I really like is the patients that I see. And I find with high-risk obstetrics, pregnancy is such a special time for a couple and for a patient. And having the added stress of a complicated pregnancy can be hard for people. And I really value my role in being able to sit down and talk to patients and explain things, maybe take a little bit of time to explain things, even a second or third time until people understand. And I really value that I can come to work and make a big difference in someone's life, really, because that's going to be a big thing that they're embarking on, which is a pregnancy.
And what are some challenges that you find comes with working in maternal fetal medicine?
One of the big challenges, I would say, on a day-to-day basis is sometimes it's not, you know, the happiest area. Sometimes there's very unfortunate, upsetting things that happen. People get diagnosed with cancer at a very difficult time in their lives. Sometimes there's very bad news to give about a pregnancy that's not going as expected, or even a stillborn baby. So sometimes it is hard, trying not to take that home and have that affect you. Can be hard sometimes, but you have to take a step back and realize that there's so much good that you're doing for these people and this population that really the good does outweigh the bad for sure. But sometimes they're quite difficult cases to see.
And are you involved in any teaching or precepting of PA students?
So I am. Located at McMaster makes it really easy to pop by the McMaster School, the PA program there, and do some teaching. So I am part of the problem-based learning tutorials, specifically for the reproductive system. And I think I bring sort of that subspecialty to the table and allow that different way of thinking. So I've been doing that for 3 years now with the PA program at McMaster. We love students. So we're always happy to take on students for usually second year, just because of sometimes the sensitivity of the content that we see. We usually ask students to come for a 2-week block rather than a day where they might just be in and out. But we happily take students all times of the year.
And any tips for PA students interested in pursuing a career or an elective in maternal fetal medicine or OBGYN?
It's a little bit difficult because there's not very many PAs in this area. So I think there's a lot of questions over what a PA can and cannot do. Can a PA be useful in this area? And the answer is yes. I've been there for 4 years and I think I've brought a lot to the table. So my advice to people would be seek advice. email me. I'm always there to help people who want to get into this area of medicine as well. And chat with your preceptor. Be creative in ways that a PA can work in the clinic, because I've seen firsthand that it can.
Well, the PA role is still new here in Canada. How often do you get asked, what is a PA? And what do you usually say in response?
When I'm asked what a PA is by whether it's patients or other healthcare providers, or what can we do, I usually give a brief explanation of what I do and how I work. But I think it goes to show that actually sitting there and talking to a patient or giving them information, actions speak louder than words. I think if a patient is not really sure, if they haven't had an experience with a PA before, telling them, you know, what my credentials are, you know, only gets you so far. I think sitting down and talking to a patient and getting a good rapport with them and showing them that you have the knowledge and the skill set to treat them and gaining their trust from that perspective is the best way to go about that.
Mm-hmm. And are you happy with your decision to become a PA?
I am. I've spoken to a lot of people in other careers that, I mean, every career has its pros and cons, but I'm very happy with my decision. You know, one thing when I first started looking at medical careers, the MD route was something that I was really interested in, and I ultimately chose PA, and I'm very, very happy about that for a couple reasons. One being that the lifestyle, I think, is a big deal. I know I don't do very well with no sleep. I learned that in clerkship. I struggled with that, and the fact that I don't have to do call shifts as a PA really impacts my mental health. Even. The other thing is I'm able to practice in a very subspecialized area without having to go into a lot of the debt and a lot of the years of life that it takes to be that type of specialist.